He travels the world helping people overcome their phobias and life obstacles, and he's actually the person who first inspired me to pick this topic. So believe it or not, I actually, until recently, had extreme arachnophobia. So if I saw a picture of a tarantula or a spider, I would get the heebie-jeebies. People would send pictures to me as jokes. One time I went to a PetSmart and saw a giant bird eating a tarantula and almost fainted. It was pretty bad. All my coworkers are here, they know that recently I actually held a giant tarantula. So I've been working to overcome my fear. Something that's helped me is this guy right here. He's angry. This is Antares. Antares is a vinegaroon, which is a type of whip scorpion. So he does have eight legs, just like a giant tarantula, but he doesn't have all the hair that really freaks me out. So I kind of use him as a stepping stone to get over my phobia. Overcoming a phobia, it relieves you from the stress and uncomfortable feelings that it can cause you. And then it can also give you the tools to overcome other obstacles in your life. And then it can make you aware of the impact your responses to things has on other people. So many of you in the audience are probably uncomfortable, even though these animals aren't actually in the room. They're just pictures. So that is what a phobia is. It's an irrational fear. These things aren't here. They can't hurt you. Yet I see many of you cringing. So that's what a phobia is. Now, I want you to imagine that this is a real chalkboard. Now, I'm scraping across it with my long fingernails. And usually when I do that demonstration in front of people, they cringe. But why? Maybe they imagined what it would sound like. Maybe they imagine what it would feel like on their own fingernails if they scratched across it. So that is how phobia works. We create these stories in our minds with our imaginations that upset us so much that even a picture of a chalkboard, not a real one, or pictures of snakes and little spiders makes us uncomfortable. And that is because your nervous system does not know the difference between your imagination and reality. Well, usually when I tell people that, they really sit there and they think about the fact, wow, like, I just freaked myself out just from my thoughts. You don't realize how much your thoughts can really control you. So your phobia does not benefit you. Raise your hand if you like feeling super uncomfortable. Exactly. You know, that's not a pleasant feeling to have, right? It puts stress on your body. It causes you to be upset. And so these small objects, like a little spider or a picture of a chalkboard, can control your mind and emotions. There's very few spiders that can't be taken out with a vacuum cleaner. This was said by a man named Richard Bandler, and he is the co-creator of one of the most powerful self-improvement methods. And I watched an interview by him, and it actually made me laugh. He said, I tell my patients sometimes, well, you could have been a vacuum cleaner and holster it to your belt, and you could walk around for the rest of your life with a vacuum cleaner, and at least then you'd be proactive about your phobia. And he makes the point of adding up how much time these people are worried about spiders when spiders aren't even around. And I know I've done this, going through an old bag of clothes. You're uncomfortable the entire time because you're just waiting for a spider to jump out. And whenever I was younger, I would clean my room when I had piles of clothes. And usually, you don't even see a spider. Yet you spend the entire day that you're cleaning super worried that a spider's going to jump out at you. So if you're worried about spiders for just 15 minutes a week, multiply that by 52 weeks, and that means that in a year, you're worried about spiders for 780 minutes. How many years have you been worried about spiders? How many more years have you been worried about spiders? That's a lot of time in your life spent worrying about something that's not even around when you could be having fun. Nothing is good or bad, but thinking makes it so. And this was said by Gary Cox, and we're about to learn about his four-step process. But before then, it's important to have an open mind. And in order to have an open mind, you need to have perspective. I love warm weather. I love going to Florida, I love being on the beach. My cousin loves cold weather. Whenever we go on family vacation, he only comes out to the beach when it's raining. That doesn't mean that hot weather's evil, and that doesn't mean that cold weather's bad. That just means that we have different opinions. I've spent my entire life being passionate about animals that make some of you sick to your stomach. It's all about perspective. And once you realize that just because you have negative feelings towards something doesn't make it bad, it's a lot easier for you to take the steps to overcome feeling bad about something. So he's developed a four-step process for this, and you can actually use it in any aspect of your life. So if you overcome your fear of snakes or spiders, you can use the same technique to overcome stress from school. or work, or if you're really bad at spending all your money as soon as you get your paycheck, you can train yourself to not do that. You have the ability to control your thoughts and emotions. So the first step is why. Usually everyone's reasons come back to the fact that they want to be in control of their mind and emotions. When they see a snake, it makes them really uncomfortable. They don't want to feel uncomfortable anymore. They don't want that little snake to control them. They want to control how they feel. And so I actually use this process on my mother. If she's driving down the road and she sees a snake on the road and she's driving, she picks up her feet and starts screaming. She's so scared of them. I once watched her go into shock. She turned white. She started shaking just from seeing a dead snake in her house. So she was like the extreme of fearful of snakes. A few weeks ago, I invited her to my office, and it was a really big deal to get her to even come in my office because I have four snakes in there. And by the end of this process, she actually held my biggest snake. So this works. I've tried it out on my mom. We sat for about an hour and a half, and she took notes, and I really discussed all of this with her and practiced on her. And before you can begin this process, you need to understand your reason for it. My reason is that I want to work with animals. I can't go and work at a zoo and tell them, well, I'll take care of everything here except for the spiders. You can't do that. The spiders need to be taken care of too. So your reason might just be that you don't want to be uncomfortable anymore. Step two is your limited belief. The limited belief is what you tell yourself you have to do when you see the object you're afraid of. So for example, whenever I ask my mom, what would you do if I got a snake out right now? She said, well, I'd be out of this room. So that's what you tell yourself. You tell yourself, if you see that object that you're afraid of, you have to run away. And getting over phobia is not just simply facing your fears. You can't take a person who's terrified of bridges and put them on a bridge and be like, all right, you're over it. That's not gonna work. They're gonna be petrified, right? And so if someone's really scared of spiders and I just throw a spider in their face, that's gonna add to their trauma. So it's not just facing your fears. You can't just get really brave one day and say, okay, I'm gonna do it, and then look at one. It's not gonna cure you. You actually have to change your thought process. And so that's what this does. So step three is your empowering belief. Your empowering belief is basically just the opposite of your limited belief. So if you tell yourself you have to run out of the room when you see the snake, the opposite of that is that you don't have to run. So these are polar opposites, and the goal is by the end of the process, the person will believe this instead of their limited belief. Step four is new experiences and feelings. So like I said before, those limited beliefs are buried very deep in your mind, and you have to change your thought process. So people make up these stories in their head, just like you did with the chalkboard, of snakes are slimy. Snakes are, they'll bite me, they're super fast, they'll sneak up on me, and you tell yourself all these crazy stories. But how do you know that all snakes are mean if you won't let yourself be in a room with one? How do you know that snakes are slimy if you've never touched one? Snakes aren't actually slimy. And so usually when someone's never touched a snake before and they'll touch one of my snakes, I see their facial expressions change. I see them lay back and really think about their whole life. Because all these stories they've told themselves for years and years, they're figuring out, wow, that's not even true. And so that's what this step is that those people, after you've disproven all their validations that they've made up about their phobia, you want to teach them the new facts. And so I've noticed that the more I learn about an animal, the less threatening it seems. Once you learn how to act around it, once you learn facts about how to take care of it, it becomes less scary. And so that's what this is. You want to create those new positive experiences. You don't want to let a really scary spider around someone who's overcoming their phobia, right? You want to expose them to animals that are nice. So overcoming a phobia is a really big commitment, and it's something that only you can decide. No one can force you to overcome one. They can just encourage you, but it's something that you have to decide for yourself, and it's a big commitment. Facing your fears is really scary, and so if you aren't ready for that, then at least leave with this last lesson. Think about the fact that two things that people usually have phobias about in our culture are snakes and spiders. Why is that? Why is it not horses or any other animal that we're around all the time? It's because fears are contagious. So I was originally scared of spiders and snakes because my mom taught me to. And so your phobias, you can project them onto other people, and your reaction to something can actually spread the fear. And so I've noticed that small children are usually super enthusiastic about my animals. So I'll get out giant Madagascar and some cockroaches, and these kids are wanting to hold them, pet them, take them home with them. When they go from like this, reaching out to touch my animal, to sad and confused, and then scared, when their mom runs up frantic and goes, "Ew, don't touch that!" and you know, moves their hands out of the way, and then that's just created a traumatizing event for that kid that they're going to carry with them to their adulthood, and that's going to be one of their validations for their phobia, just like the parent had the phobia, the child is too. And so I know it's really hard to control yourself when you're scared of something and not display your fear, but a better reaction for that parent would have been to say, "Wow, I'm scared of that, but I'm proud of you for touching something that I'm scared to touch." You know, so it's always important to encourage those around you. Don't project your phobias onto other people. Allow them to make their own decisions about something. I'm never going to bring animals to a program that could hurt anybody. So it's a safe environment, and so I always try and encourage the parents to be brave for their kids so that they can not grow up being scared of something. Have hope. If I can do it, I promise you can. I seriously used to not even be able to look at pictures, and now look at me. I'm holding this eight-legged animal, and it's not bothering me at all. So the reason that I decided to, you know, face all my fears was because I want to work with animals, and I can't just work with some of them. I want to be able to work with all of them. So you might have your own reasons for wanting to overcome it. You might just want to be brave for your kids. If you are wrong about your ability to hold a giant spider, then you are wrong about every limitation. The same techniques that you use to overcome phobias can be used in any aspect of your life, so you actually have the ability to open doors and destroy limitations.
Yay!